Peace, 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 peace. Good morning, my brothers and sisters. Can you make some noise for the Creator? Please make some noise. Because it was only by Him that I was able to bring this divine information to you by way of this living vessel, which operates based off the spirit and soul that created the contract, which is created from comes from what we call a divine trust to a true trust. So the Creator is trusted in me to give this divine message to you all by way of my spirit and energy so that you can resurrect from the dead and realize that you are members of the Holy Church from the Church of England and descended down from those kings and queens known as the Anglo-Saxon Berbers. And we're going to prove that today. We're going to truly prove that today because, once again, as I've proven, that the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants created this theory called the Church Invisible or the Invisible Church. All right? Now, let's briefly go back over this again before we go into connecting the dots in lieu of the so-called true church or the visible church was created by the Berbers or the Anglo-Saxon. I'm going to prove that right here today. So please, you know, respond, leave a message. If you don't agree or if you disagree, or if you agree, please respond to this because, you know, I'm calling everyone out to try to bring us to a full or a conclusion, an undoubtable conclusion that this is who and what we are as a people, all right? And this is who we honor and respect it or worship as a people, ourselves, and the divine energy and spirit that created our divine selves as divine immortal beings, all right? So check this out. We're talking about the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants, which was an elite or elect group who created what we call the Invisible Church or Church Invisible. Okay? So now let's get through this real quick. It's going to be a short message again today. You see here it says, Church Invisible. The invisible church or church invisible is a theological concept of an invisible Christian church of the elect. You see that? Of the elect. Now, as I told you before in my previous lesson, that the so-called white Anglo-Saxon Protestant is a group of elect, specific beings. All right? You can read white Anglo-Saxon Protestant and you will get the meaning of what they call themselves. Matter of fact, let's go there before we do anything so we can connect the dots. White Anglo-Saxon Protestants. All right. Real brief. White Anglo-Saxon Protestants are a social group, an elect group of white Protestants in the United States. And I'm talking about, once again, no other territory but the United States. All right. And the United States was not created till after the Revolutionary War, which created their independence from the British colonies, who they were descendants of, all right? So they didn't even agree with what their descent forefathers was doing because it was based off fraud, deceit, slavery, and so on and so forth. So it says, white Anglo-Saxon Protestants are a social group or elect group of white Protestants in the United States of British descent, and typically wealthy and well-connected. The group has long dominated American society, culture, and the leadership of major political parties, and had a monopoly on elect elite, elect, whatever you want to choose, term you choose to use, society due to intermarriage and nepotism. All right? Let's go back here, invisible church. Okay. Visible church or church invisible? The visible church or church invisible is a theological concept of the invisible Christian church of the elect who are known only to God. In contrast to the visible church, that is the institutional body on earth which preaches the gospel and ministers the sacraments. All right? Let's go to the overview of it. Overview. The concept has been attributed to St. Augustine of Hippo as a part of his refutation of the Donatist sect. He was strongly influenced by the Platonist belief that true reality is invisible and that if the visible reflects the invisible, it does so only partially and imperfectly. See Theory of Forms. You can do that on your own. But he wanted to go to find out who this guy is, St. Augustine of Hippo, because he created the concept of the invisible or visible church, which was followed by the Protestants known as the White Anglo-Saxons. All right? So, St. Augustine of Hippo, let's get an idea who this guy was. Hold on to your seats, my brothers and sisters. Hold on to your seats. All right? Augustine of Hippo. We're going to take our time with this one. You see, with the Pope, headdress on, and the symbolic of the fish. All right, the sign of Pisces, all right, which is also the Berber sign, all right? This represents the sign of Pisces, which is the Berber sign. If you look on the flag of the Berber, it was created in 1970, the year I was born. And the new year for the Berber is January the 14th. It's also my birthday. So the flag was created in 1970, the year I was born, but the new year for the Berbers is January the 14th. It's also my birthday. So please, somebody tell me why there's significance or uniformity with my birthday and the day I was born in reference to the Berber flag and the sign of the Pisces, in which you see here the Roman popes wearing itself. All right? All right. Augustine of Hippo. Let me make sure you brothers and sisters can see that. Yeah, you can see that. All right. All right, let's pull it up on Wikipedia yourselves. Get your computers and pull it up yourselves. All right. We're going to show how this connected to the Berbers, because it was Augustine of Hippo who created the so-called concept of an invisible church or church visible, which is connected to slavery of the invisible church, which our brothers and sisters are subject to based off ignorance, which was established by what we call the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants, which are associated with the white with the visible church, which they gave us. They gave us an invisible concept instead of honoring the visible, gave us an invisible concept instead of honoring the visible concept, which we passed down to our descent, our children, and so on and so forth. Okay, but they so-called saying that Augustine of Hippo created this concept, which is not the case, because they say he was born in August 28th, 430 AD. Well, we know that 430 AD under the Gregorian calendar did not exist, because the Gregorian calendar was not created till 1582 by Pope Gregory the 15th in 1582 AD. All right, look it up. The Gregorian calendar was not created till 1582 by Pope Gregory the 13th. All right, the Gregorian Reformation was created in 579 by Pope Gregory the 1st when all the Anglo-Saxons had to adopt Christianity. All right. So it says Augustine of Hippo was a Roman African, early Christian theologian, and Neoplatonic philosopher from Numidia, whose writing influenced the development of the Western church and Western philosophy. Indirectly, all the Western Christianity. He was the bishop of Hippo Regis in North Africa. All right? Now, I've seen that. He was the Hippo Regis. He was of Hippo Regis in North Africa. First of all, you want to find out, he's a Roman African. What is a Roman African? All right? We're going to get through that, but give me a second. Let me go down a little further. Here you see the Council of Nicene. Right here. The segment of the church that adhered to the concept of the Trinity as defined by the Council of Nicene and the Council of Constantinople. These were fraudulently presented because these Council of Nicene and the Council of Constantinople did not exist because the calendar or date supported was not created till 1582. And the only calendar in support prior to that creation was that of the Berber calendar. All right? You can look it up. Let's go a little further. It says here. One second. Where's it at? You see that? Augustine is the patron saint of the brewers, printers, and theologians in a number of cities and dioceses. Many Protestants, especially Calvinists and Lutherans, consider him to be the one of the theological fathers of the Protestant Reformation. Did you hear that? Protestant Reformation due to his teachings on salvation and divine grace. There we go. This is where the Anglo-Saxons, white Anglo-Saxon Protestants get their creation of the visible church from this guy, St. Augustine of Hippo, okay? He was the founder or the father of the Protestant concept, which we know they say he was, but how can he even exist when the date he used or the date of his so-called existence could not exist because it's not supported by a valid calendar, all right? So now look at the corresponding date. What was the date? 354 and 430 AD under the Gregorian calendar, and look at the date corresponds to it under the Berber calendar, and you will see that this is actually the Berber year. All right? It's the Berber year. All right? Not a Gregorian year, but the Berber year. Okay, let's go a little further with this. He said he was a bishop, okay? It says, was a Christian Roman African, early Christian theologian, and Neoplatonic philosopher from Numidia, whose writing influenced the development of the Western church and Western philosophy, and indirectly all Western Christianity. He was the bishop of Hippo Regis in North Africa and is viewed as one of the most important church fathers of the Latin church. Okay, so the term bishop is a term that was founded or origin goes back to England. All right? Because England used the Berber calendar prior to 1582. All right? The bishop was created by a bishop by the name of Leofric. Leofric of, Leofric of Exeter. All right, he was a bishop. He's the one who changed the monks to bishops. All right, which created the so-called canons. Look the brother up, Leofric, spelled L-E-O-F-R-I-C, of Exeter, E-X-T-E-R. He's the one who changed the monks to bishops because back prior to there being bishops deriving their authority under canon law, they were called monks. All right, and they were part of what they called the Benedictine Monastery, which was a school of black monks. All right, these were Berbers. All right, so the term bishop comes from, like I said, England. Old England. Old England, going back to the time of, around the time of the 800 AD, 900 AD. All right, so look it up. Leofric. He was a Leofric of Exeter. I think he was a bishop of St. Dunstan. All right, look him up yourself. Don't quote me, but you will see that there has a correlation to it. All right. So now it says he was a Roman African. Roman African. You see that? Let's look at what that is, a Roman African. You see that? A Roman African. Remember, Wikipedia is baby food for children. And we are still considered children because we are legally incapacitated to deal with our own status or affairs because we don't know who we are as a people. We can't govern our state as a people. So I'm here to correct that. Roman Africans. Roman Africans, Latin and Arabic, Africa, are the ancient northwestern African population of Roman North Africa. You hear that? How could there be a Roman North Africa? All right? We understand Roman comes not from the biblical Roman because there's no account to support it. Roman comes from Pope Gregory the First under what they call the British Empire, 1714. This is what they're talking about. They had Romanized culture and used to speak their own variety of Latin as a result. They existed mostly from Roman conquests in the antiquity to the Arab conquests of North Africa and the early Middle Ages. Did you hear that? Now they're mentioning Arabs. Now they're mentioning Arabs. Okay, let's get a little deeper. All right. Right there. Roman Africans lived in the coastal cities of contemporary Tunisia, Western Libya, and Eastern Algeria. This area became known under Arab rule as Africa, an Arabized version of the name of the Roman province of Africa. Did you hear that? So now, this had some undermining by Romans and Arabs. Okay? This is how we were classified as so-called Moors, which is the Latin word Maurice. All right, we're going to get into that. Go back there a little further. Right here. It says, make sure you brothers and sisters can read it. It says, the Roman Africans were generally local Berbers or Punics, but also the descendants of the population that came directly from Rome itself or the diverse regions of the empire as legionaries and senators. All right, here you see. You see, Berber and Punic. Maghrebi Arabic as a result of language shift. As a result of language shift. Did you hear that? All right, let's go to here where it mentions. Give me 1 second. All right. Here we go. See that? Characteristics. Put on your thinking cap, my brothers and sisters. We are not Moors. We are Berbers. Because even the God created the invisible church by the name of Augustin of Hippo, who created the invisible church and took away the visible church and created an invisible church, which was instituted by the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants. All right? So the true church was created by the Anglo-Saxons, which is a visible church, as contrast to that of an invisible church created by white Anglo-Saxon Protestants, which history goes back to that of St. Augustine, which did not exist prior to, in lieu of a validated calendar. So all this has to deal with the so-called British descendants under King George I in 1714 when they stole the history of that of England, which were Anglo-Saxons, so that they can exist as an indigenous people, which they are not. Okay? So it says the Roman Africans in lieu of characteristics were first adopted. The Roman African first adopted the Roman pantheon under the rule of the Roman Republic. You hear that? Under the rule of the Roman Republic, but then were one of the first provinces to convert to the Christianity, and among their most known figures, we can mention Saint Felicita, Saint Perpetua, Saint Cyprian, and Saint Augustine. Contrarily to the so-called Maori that mostly inhabit the westmost part of Northwest Africa and were barely Romanized, Roman Africans like Septuagint, Severus, or St. Aurelius Augustinus had Latin names in addition to speaking Latin. All right? So now we go to Maori. Maori is a Latin term for the English word Moor. But it's a nickname given to dark-skinned people who were not necessarily called Moor, who were not Moors. It's French. All right? So there we get the word, English word Moor for the Latin word or the French word Maurice. Alright? And we understand that they with themselves come from the creation that was created by St. Augustine of Hippo. Alright? So they take away the Berber's true church, which was a visible church, which were based off the Anglo-Saxon tribes of England, which was called the Church of England. Alright? And they derived their own particular law called canon law. Called canon law. All right, so now where are we going to go next? Let's go back here. Hippo Augustine. Let's go. He was the bishop of Hippo Regis. Check it out. Hippo Regis. Hippo Regis, also known as Hippo or Hipponi. Hipponi is the ancient name of the modern city of Annaba in Algeria. Hippo Regis was a Phoenician, Berber, and Roman city in present-day Annaba province in Algeria. Did you hear that? Was a Phoenician and Berber. Now, in the Bible, they don't refer to Berber. They call them Phoenicians. This is when they stole the story and created an invisible story that was created from what they call a myth or theory. And this story was created by the so-called British Empire, who were Romans, the true Romans, not that spook Romans that were created by a theology, was created by philosophers. That's not supported by a valid calendar, other than the calendar was created in 1582 by Pope Gregory the 13th. All right? So come on now, let's be serious about this. We call ourselves indigenous, but how can we be indigenous when we have no proof of validity of who we are as a people? No proof whatsoever. No proof, my brothers and sisters. Okay, where else I'm going to go with this? All right. He looked up Invisible Church. Was amongst the slaves in the United States. Okay? This stuff was only practiced in the United States. Give me one second, my brothers and sisters. Okay. So now they said they associated St. Augustine of Hippo, which was dealing with the African Romans or Roman Africans, all right, which associated with Maurice. Okay, so let's look up Maurice family crest. You see that? Origin. France and Wales. All right? Not England. Maurice. M-A-U-R-I-C-E. The Maurice. Let me make sure you're there. The Maurice surname comes from an old French personal name introduced to Britain by the Normans. The French, you hear that? William the Conqueror. All right? The Latin version was Mauritius. It's also thought to that the name may okay, it said the Maurice surname comes from an old French personal name introduced to Britain by the Normans. The Latin version was Mauritius. It is also thought that the name may have been taken on as a nickname for a Moor or someone of dark complexion who was not actually a Moor. You hear that? Do you hear that? I don't think y'all did. I don't think y'all actually heard that. Okay, you see that? Give me 1 second. All right, the early origins of the Maurice family. Surname Maurice was first found in Herefordshire. And it's a Hereford County, it's a Herefordshire. Where traditions, according to historians, Armorod finds the family name to be descended from Asserton, okay? Glorid, or godson of Asserton, the king of England. Asserton was ruler of Kingdom of England in 927, okay? But he was not a Moor, for the French word Maurice. He was not that. He was a Berber. So they mentioned it connected to Asserton, but Asserton was not a Maurice because Asserton was not a French. He was of England. Let's go prove that. King of England. All right? Right there. And left a highlight for you so you can click onto it. All right. They mentioned it going back to... 1 second. Here. Around the time that Stonehenge was built, the society moved to the Bronze Age. They're taking it all the way back to Stonehenge, England. Okay? So let's go here. I showed you this before. See, what St. Augustine did on behalf of Rome was erased our history and erased our way of worship. Okay, he claimed to be of Roman African descent and do away the Berber history. Okay? Now, we already found associated the word Maurice, which is the English word Moor, associated with the French. Now, let's make sure we disconnect it because it said it was a name given to somebody who was dark-skinned who was not necessarily a Moor. Okay? Now, here you hear the word, see the word Berber. You see that? Origin England. Origin England. This is where your health is going to come from. This is how you heal yourself. You go to any hospital for the Knights of Hospital or the Knights of Knights of the Crusade, Jerusalem, protectors of Jerusalem. They're the ones who are able and kept the secret. They're the ones who kept the secret on how you're able to heal yourself through the flag of England, which is the nation, which is the territory, which is your land, which is your estate. Okay? Anywhere in the hospital, you see that symbol. It represents healing, health. All right? The cross White purity. Ancient arms. You see the symbol, fleur-de-lis. You go back to the Merovingian dynasty, was being handed this by an angel. But the word angel was symbolic of the word Anglo or Anglo or angel. Anglo, angel, Anglo are words that originated with the Anglo-Saxon people, which means messenger of God. All right? The fleur-de-lis was given to, or so-called given to Clovis, founder of the Merovingian dynasty, which so-called said were supposed to be the first inhabitants of what we call United States or North America. Which was a law, a lie. They were the Berbers who were the indigenous people because it said under the Merovingian dynasty, if you watch my previous dynasty, they said they never claimed to be descendants of God like the Anglo-Saxon descendants. Okay? I don't know what this is right here. I'm trying to erase this. It says, a certain name, Berber, was first found in Leeshire, where they held their family seat from ancient times. You hear that? In England, not in French. All right? Important data from the Berbers. Let's not go there. Let's go here. The history of the name Berbers begins with the Anglo-Saxon tribes of Britain. Okay? Now, look into that statement. The history of the name Berber begins with the Anglo-Saxon tribes of Britain. Britain was known as, was established by what they call Buddhists of Troy, who invaded Albion, which was the land of the giants, which was a reference to the biblical books and reference to giants. All right? And and the emperor of Albion was King Edgar the Peaceful, an Asiatic brother. All right? He was the first king of England to ever wear a crown. But there were other kings prior to him that were took on the title as king, such as Astrington, 927. All right? Which goes back to the word Berbers, but the name Maurice was given to him by foreigners, such as William the Conqueror or the French. All right, well, we just seen that the word, English word more, which is the French word, Latin word, Maurice, comes from French, but not the Berber. We just read Berber comes from England. Come on, brothers and sisters. Anglo-Saxon tribes of Britain. We're talking about here in America because the Britain was created by what they call King George the First in 1714. When it was passed from the Anglo-Saxon tribes under the House of Stuart by Queen Anne, 1714, okay? King George, House of Britain, or the Kingdom of Britain, was under the Roman Empire. So the spook story you're talking about is the visible story which created based off the founding of this country. It is derived from the baptismal name, meaning son of Barbara. In some instances, the name may have also been a nickname for someone such as a Moor or a Berber who appeared to be of North African heritage. In such case, the name is a reference to the Barbary coast of North Africa. Do you hear that? Now, as we've just seen, according to the Board of Freeholders, North Africa was connected to what we call the east coast of what we call North America, in which Middlesex County was the center of it. This was the Creoles said themselves. These is one who are sitting in a lowlier position of the so-called land, your estate. But you don't want to claim your estate because you want to be somebody else. Could somebody please deal with this situation? Because I'm trying to. I'm trying to, brothers and sisters. So there you go. There's your proof. See that castle right there? There's your proof. Okay, let's go back Where else I'm going to go with this? All right. I know what I want to do. Check this out. Let's go here. Let's get some proof, my brothers and sisters. Let's get some proof. Let's get some proof. Let me just show y'all a little something right quick. I'm gonna show you real quick. Hold on, because I don't want that one. Let's go here. You see that? This is the affidavit of oath in lieu of the probate court, which was transferred to, ecclesiastical court was transferred to the probate court in 1857. All right, so probate court or circuit court has to deal, let me blow it up. I'm kind of skeptical about showing y'all this because most of us just want a so-called benefit. And this movement is not about a benefit. All right? It's about a right. Okay. Here you see? Ecclesiastical courts, or court of Christian, or court of spiritual, was transferred to the courts of probate or surrogate court by way of the Probate Act of 1857. Okay? What you have to do in lieu of the probate, i.e. ecclesiastical court that was transferred in 1857, you have to petition for a letter of testamentary of office of general guardian executor of your legal name in person and executor of the mind, body, spirit of the legal name as under guardian as a living will or trust corpus with our assets that exist based off the energy and spirit that creates what they call a living corporate body estate, which is a physical body, a living vessel. Okay? And this is a will created, a created safe will. Created self-will. It's called a self-proven will. All right? Right there. Self-proven testamentary will of trust. Okay? And it's supported by canon law. But most of y'all are just going to take this document and for a benefit. I'm not giving it to you. I'm not going to do that. No, I'm not. But let's go back to what I wanted to show you, brothers and sisters. Okay? Pictures. Camera roll. Let's see. Let me find it. That's not it. Right here. These are my degrees. I didn't came to and show myself. I've been a part of the more scientific America. This is my seventh heavens diploma for Sikhism. You know what I'm saying? This is my resurrection chamber. So I've been through the chambers, brother. I've been there. But school don't stop there, brother. School don't stop there. I've been through the AEO, Ancient Egyptian Order. I've been born again. My name is Nubi Sepkawa El Bey. So I've been there. But it don't stop there. Apparently, most of us has just stopped. Okay? Let me go here. Let's find the file. Let's see if this is it. No, that's not it. Give me 1 second. I got him. I shot a video on this. Come on. Camera roll. 2019. Let's try one. Nope. It's probably the next one. Let's go here. I suggest each and every one of y'all pull this up. This is my family crest. Let's rotate. There you go. Let's blow it up. All right, this is my family crest, Jefferson. Breakdown of it. Certificate of authenticity from the house of name. I suggest each and every one of y'all do that. It shows you the origin where your surname comes from. All right? But let me go back to where I was trying to go to, my pictures. Oh, where is it at? Pictures. Camera roll. This might be it. No, that's not it. That's my grandfather. Right there. Let me just go ahead. No, I ain't gonna show you that. Not yet. Not gonna show you that. Not yet. Let me just go back here. I got it. Just give me a second. Yeah, I ain't going nowhere anyhow, so just hold on. 2019. Third row. This might be it. Hold up. Let me close out. Hope you didn't peep that. Made a mistake. I ain't gonna show you that because I ain't gonna can't find the picture. I don't want to reveal something to you that you don't. Alright. Oh boy. I might have to erase this video because I didn't want to show y'all that. But let's close out of here. I was trying to find a picture of a picture of the Berber, something relative to the Berber family crest. But with that, I'm going to end this video and I'm going to close out. And just leave them wondering minds to draw their own conclusions of what it is I'm trying to build to them. With that, I say peace.